In this video, we are going to discuss a new application of diodes, which is called the clipping or limiting circuits. And as might be clear from the name, these circuits, they limit or clip the voltage, specifically the output voltage, from going above a certain level, or sometimes from going below a certain level. So for example, you can design a limiting circuit that prevents the output voltage of the circuit from going above 15 volt, or from going below a negative 10 volt, for example. This is very useful in practice because in some applications like the amplifiers, you don't want the input voltage to the amplifier to go above a certain voltage level. Why? Because the input transistor and the other transistors inside the amplifier may burn. They may saturate if the input voltage goes above a certain voltage level. So you want the input voltage to these amplifiers to be within a certain range. They do not go above a certain voltage level and they do not go below a certain voltage level. And there are many, many other applications for the limiting circuits or clipping circuits. I consider this part to be the most tricky part in the diode applications. Why? Because the limiting circuits, they do not have a specific design. They do not have a specific structure. They can come in many variations. So you will see when you solve problems on the limiting circuits, you don't see like a specific or a fixed structure for the limiting circuits. They can come in many, many different structures. And for each structure, you have to think about it. And in order to solve it, you have to think about it in a different way from the other structures that you have seen. And what we'll do here is we are going to solve some examples, some famous examples on the limiting circuits. And then as you solve problems, you will gain experience of how to deal with these circuits, how to solve these circuits. Since we are talking about a range of V output and consequently a range of V input, we say that the V output will appear in this range, but it will be clipped in this range. Here for the limiting circuits or clipping circuits, we will be interested in plotting something called the transfer function, the relation between the input and the output. This is called the transfer function. So most of the time, we'll be interested, if I gave you a limiting circuit or a clipping circuit, we'll be interested to plot this transfer function, this relation. We plot the output for many values of V input, not only for one value of V input. We are going to plot or sketch how the output looks like for all the range or all the values of V input. This is what we call the transfer function, okay? It is possible that I will ask you what is the output when the input is exactly 4 volt. So here we need to solve the circuit exactly for one point. So what you can do here is you can use the methods of circuit analysis or diode circuit analysis that we learned before, assume, solve, check, in order to solve for only this point when V input is 4 volt. But most of the time, I'm going to ask you, for the limiting circuits, I'm going to ask you to plot the transfer function, which is the relation between V output and V input for the whole range of V input. Then after you plot this transfer function, I'm going to tell you if V input looks like this. For example, it looks like a triangular wave that goes between, let's say, 5 volt and negative 5 volt. This is V input with time. How the output is going to look like with time. Plot the output with time. So these are the typical questions and typical problems that we need to solve in any limiting circuit. First, you plot the transfer function, and then for a certain V input that changes with time, plot V output, how it changes with time. So basically, these are the two famous questions that you will get on any limiting or clipping circuit. Okay, let's start with the first example. Very, very simple limiting circuit that consists of a voltage source, V input, resistor, diode, and here the diode is connected to a certain voltage source VC. And for simplicity, let's assume that the diode is idle. Let's in the beginning assume that the diode is idle. We need to plot the transfer function. So in order to plot the transfer function, let's think about this circuit, how this circuit works. Generally, for any vehicle without the circuit boards, you will need to ask yourself one question. This diode, look at this diode and ask yourself, when would this diode be on and when would this diode be off? Look at the critical point of this diode. So this is the question that makes sense. When you look at a circuit like this, you will ask yourself, the first question you will ask, when would the diode be on and when would the diode be off? And let's start, always try to start with, when would the diode be off? Ask yourself, when would the diode be off? So as we see here in this example, the negative side of the diode is connected to a voltage VC, and the positive side is connected to Vout. So we have Vout here, this is our circuit, R. We have the positive side of the diode is connected to a voltage Vout, and the negative side of the diode is connected to a voltage VC, and this is our input voltage, this is the output. So the voltage here is Vout, and the voltage of this point is VC. So the first question we'll ask, when would this diode be off? And always start with the off case. This diode will be off as long as Vout, the voltage here, is less than VC. So the diode, you write like this, the diode will be off as long as Vout is less than VC, right? In this case, for the case the diode will be off, it will be an open circuit. So the circuit will look like this. In this case, what is the relation between Vout and Vinput? This is the relation that we want to plot, right? So we ask ourselves, what is the relation in this case when the diode is off, which means that Vout is less than VC? So let's first go here. We say that the diode will be off when Vout is less than VC. So we make a line like this, and we say that this is a line at VC, at value VC, and we say that the diode is going to be off in this region. The diode is going to be off here, and the diode will be on starting from this line. So let's study this region when the diode is off. When the diode is off, the circuit will look like this. When the circuit looks like this, there is no current in the circuit, I equals zero, and thus if there is no current, V out is between this point and the ground, V out will be equal to exactly V input. So in this case, V out will be equal to V input, which means if you want to plot it here for the region that the diode is off, V out equals to V input, this means that you have a line of slope 1. So you will get a line of slope equals 1. The slope of this line equals 1. So this is the first region of our circuit. When the diode is off, we found the condition that Vout is less than VC, so in this region, and the relation between Vout and Vinput will be a straight line of slope 1. What happens if Vout tries to be higher than or equal to VC? In this case, the diode will be on. So the diode will be on when Vout tries to go above VC, right? But when the diode is on, since we assume it's an ideal diode, then it will be short circuit. When the diode is on, it will operate as a short circuit. And in this case, Vout will be equal to the voltage source here, which is VC, right? The voltage between these two points is Vout, and it is equal to VC. So Vout will be fixed at VC. It will not be able to increase above VC. Why? Because once the diode operates, it will operate as a short circuit. In this case, the voltage here will be clamped, or it will be limited to VC, right? So here, once we reach this point, once V input reaches VC, then the output will be equal exactly to VC. So now we calculated the transfer function. We plotted the transfer function. And this kind of limiting circuit, we call it hard limiter. Why hard limiter? Because the change between this region and this region, it's a hard change. We have like a hard change. We have a hard corner here between this region, this region. In some practical applications, we have soft limiters. Soft limiters means that they will change smoothly. They will go like this. This is in practice. So in practice, the change will be smooth a little bit, but here, theoretically, when we talk about modeling the actual diode with an ideal diode, you will find that the limiters are hard limiters, which means that the change is sharp here. We have a corner, okay? While in practice, what happens is we have soft limiters, which change smoothly between this region and the other region. Anyways, once we plotted, once we sketched, let's go back to our hard limiter, the theoretical limiter. Once we plotted the transfer function, I can give you that V input, for example, is changing like this between negative 5 volt and positive 5 volt, and I ask you plot V out. So let's plot V out on the same plot. What happens here? I will give you, for example, VC. Let's take VC equals 2 volt. In this case, as we see, as long as V input is below 2 volt, as long as V input is below VC, the output is equal to the input, right? So as long as V input is below 2 volt, which is VC, you will find that V out will be equal to V input. So V out is equal to V input as long as V input is below VC, right? And also V out is below VC. But once V input increases above VC, what happens to V out? V out will be clipped. V out will be clipped at VC. So the output will be clipped here at VC when V input increases above VC, right? So the output will look like this. It will go up, then it will be clipped at 2 volt, then it will go down as similar to V input, then it will be clipped again here. So here we have a limiting circuit, a limiter that limits the output from increasing above 2 volt. So here, in this simple circuit with ideal diode, we limited the output from increasing above the voltage called VC. We plotted the transfer function, we plotted the output with time and the input with time. If we go one more step, we add another branch. We add another branch with another diode and another voltage source. We can study the new circuit as following. We have two branches in the new circuit. So again, we'll do what we did in the previous circuit. What did we do in the previous circuit? Basically, we asked ourselves about the critical point of this diode. Where is the point at which the diode will move from being on to being off? So this is the question that you should ask for each diode. For each diode, you ask yourself, what is the critical point that will make the diode move from being off to being on? And this critical point will determine the regions of the transfer function. In this region, the diode will be off. In this region, the diode will be on. Of course, you try to get this point, the critical point, in terms of V input or V output, because these are the ones, V input and V output, these are the ones that we plot. We sketch in the transfer function. So you try to get the regions, the critical points, in terms of V input or V output. Okay? Let's look at the second circuit and we'll do the same. So for the second circuit, we have two branches. We have two branches. So let's directly here, we try to plot V input, V output. We have two branches with two diodes. Let's assume they are ideal diodes. So what we'll do, we'll ask ourselves about the first diode. When would the first diode be off? If you look at this circuit, you will find that, again, this diode, the negative terminal of the diode number one is connected to a voltage VC1. And the positive terminal is connected to V out. So this diode D1 will be off as long as V out is less than VC1. So as long as V out is less than VC1, let's make a line here. This is VC1. As long as V out is less than VC1, diode number one will be off. While if it tries to increase above, starting from this point, diode one will be on. So again, the negative terminal is connected to VC1, the positive terminal is connected to V out. The diode will be off, and always ask yourself when the diode will be off. The diode will be off as long as V out is less than VC1, and this is the critical point. So for the diode number one, the critical point is when V out is less than VC1. And then ask yourself about the second diode. The second diode, then the positive terminal of the second diode is connected to negative VC2. And the negative terminal is connected to V out. When would this diode be off? This diode will be off if the voltage here at the negative side is higher than the voltage here. So when the voltage here at the negative terminal, which is V out, is higher than the voltage here, which is negative VC2, then diode number two will be off. So we say that diode number two will be off as long as V out, the voltage at this terminal, at the negative terminal, is higher than the voltage at the positive terminal, which is higher than negative VC2. So the critical point for the second diode is V out greater than negative VC2. So let's plot the critical point. Let's assume it's V negative VC2 is here. So negative VC2. And then you say that as long as V out is greater than negative VC2, diode number two will be off. Why? The remaining region, diode two will be on. So now we calculated the critical point for diode number one, the critical point for diode number two. Now how many regions do we have? How many different regions do we have? We have three regions. In this region above VC1, we have diode number one on, diode number two off. In this region in the middle, we have diode number one off, diode number one off, in this whole region, diode number one off. And in this region, diode number two off. So both of them are off in the middle. Here, diode number two on and diode number one off. All that we need to do now is you study the relation between V out and V out in the three regions. Let's take the middle region. Start with the middle region. When both of them are off, when both diodes are off, when both diodes are off, then this will be an open circuit. This will be also an open circuit, regardless of the voltage source here and the voltage source here. It doesn't matter because there is no current that will flow. Okay, this is the resistance R. This is V input. Then V output, which is between this terminal and the ground, there is no current in the circuit, so V out will be exactly the same as V input. So when both diodes are off, when D1 equals D2, both of them are off, V out will be equal to V input. And hence we can plot the relation between V out and V input in the region where both of them are off. We can plot it as a line with a slope 1. And then let's look at the region at the top. Once V input, of course, this point will be again VC1, and this point for V input will be negative VC2. Once V input reaches VC1, this diode is going to operate. It will be short circuit. So once V input is greater than or equal to VC1, this will lead to D1 will be on, which means short circuit. And if D1 is on in short circuit, then V out will be equal to VC1. V out will be clipped at VC1. So when V input is greater than or equal to VC1, okay, then the diode number one will be on short circuit, and if diode number one is short circuit, the voltage here, which is same as V output, will be VC1. So V output will be clipped at VC1. On the other hand, in the third region here, when diode number one off and diode number two on, and this happens when V input goes below negative, when V input goes below negative VC2. When V input goes below negative VC2, diode number two will be on, short circuit. In this case, when V input is below negative VC2, diode number two will be on, where diode number one will be off. Here, diode number two was off. In this case, diode number two will be on short circuit, and in this case, V output will be how much? It will be negative VC2, right? So it will be clipped or limited at negative VC2, and this is now the transfer function of our circuit. And then I can give you any V input. I can give you any V input. For example, I can give you a sinusoidal wave. For V input, and I ask you to plot V output with time, given that VC1 equals, let's say, 2 volt, and negative VC2 is negative 1 volt, for example. So VC1 is here, and negative VC2 will be here. Okay, in this case, V output, it will be the same as V input here, between VC1 and VC2. Between VC1 and VC2, V input equals V out. But when V input increases above VC1, the output will be clipped at VC1. When V input goes below VC2, negative VC2, the output will be clipped at negative VC2, and so on. So this is how the output looks like. If the input is a sinusoidal wave that goes above 2, like let's say it goes between negative 5 and 5. We'll stop here in this video, and we'll continue with more examples in the next video, inshallah.